Squad Car 37 Live will begin momentarily. In the meantime, see if you can name this tune. Leave your best guesses in the comments below. Thank you for your patience. Squad Car 37 Live will begin momentarily. In the meantime, please enjoy this musical interlude. If you're not already following Squad Car 37 on Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube, please do so now. If you're not already following Steel Lemon Nick Ford Studio, please do so now. Squad Car 37 Live will begin momentarily. In the meantime, see if you can name this tune. Leave your best guesses in the comments below. Thank you for your patience. Squad Car 37 Live will begin momentarily. In the meantime, please enjoy this musical interlude. Thank you for waiting. Squad Car 37 Live will begin now.
Hello, good people. I'm JP with Squad Car 37, and I am joined with my good friend Nick of Steel Lemon Studios. Hello, Nick.
Hey, Jason, how you doing?
Hopefully. Pretty good, man. Pretty good.
All right. Let's see.
All right. Sounds like there might be a little bit of delay in your voice. Boy. So thanks for joining me today, and tonight we are going to do a virtual guitar lesson, right? So this is the first time I've ever done something like this, and I figured, you know, if we're going to do a virtual guitar lesson, I might as well get someone who actually is an expert teacher at guitar. So that's where you come in, Nick.
Yes, thank you, sir.
Nick, your background is, you're legit. You went to the Berklee School of Music, which is one of the premier music schools in the world, especially for guitar and, well, many other instruments. But one of my favorite guitar players, Steve Vai, obviously is a Berklee alum, and so are you. So you've joined that that group of, Berklee grads, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I was just, I was checking out that live stream of Levi Clay last. I got to mention that because it's still on my mind. About the Steve Vai 10-hour guitar challenge. We can maybe get into that, talk about that a little bit today.
Yeah, of course.
I had some fun. I was telling you just before we started that I was so warmed up yesterday because I joined that. I did 2 hours of that stuff. So we jammed a little yesterday. I was ready. Today, a little bit, maybe 10, 15 minutes maybe. So we'll see.
Well, I'm sure you're up to it. And the 10-hour workout, I watched a little bit of that and haven't done it yet. I haven't done it before. So, hats off to him for actually going through that on a live session. I mean, that's got to be like a record for a live online. That's crazy.
Yeah, it was pretty crazy. There's also he was saying that Steve I had the 30-hour guitar workout, so you might try that sometimes. That's pure madness. But
oh my god.
But yeah, no, it was like, you know, he had the water bottles with him, and people were saying it's not going to count if you take a pee break. And so yeah, it was good fun though. And he, you know, had some guests in there. I think I just missed Andy James might have been on there and a few other people, and so it's pretty cool.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah.
So for tonight, you've reached out and you've gotten some feedback and some great questions and for us to kind of dive into. So you want to start there?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I reached out on Instagram and I got a lot of good questions and I had to kind of like compile it all down, maybe 10 or so topics. So, we'll just start with them. So one of the questions I got, and I'll make sure I get the person here for a second too, was a question on arpeggios and metal scales. And let's see, I'm losing who that was now, but basically the question was, what are good scales for heavy metal? So when I do this, I'll kind of go this way. So the first scale that comes to mind immediately is the natural minor scale. So that's why, if you're in A minor, that's going to be, that's a great scale from heavy metal. You get, you know, classic metal does that. So you can play it the whole way. So that's, something, that kind of sound would be something like, you know, that sort of sound if you're improvising with it. So definitely that's a scale to check out, is the natural minor scale.
So first of all, that was awesome. Is the natural minor scale also known as Aeolian?
Yes. Yeah. If you're talking about modes, that's the Aeolian mode. Yes.
Okay.
So, and that's modes, just if we're going to be talking about modes a little bit tonight too. We had some questions on modes and modal arpeggios, but that just means there's scales within scales. So the Aeolian is the sixth mode of the C major scale, or Aeolian is the sixth mode of C major, which is that familiar tone. Believe it or not, the minor scale is actually in there. So, but that's the first one to get down. You have minor pentatonic in there as well, which is of course going to work over everything. But these color notes in there, there's a really moody note. The flat six is great for. It's that rock players, we love to be moody and dramatic. So that's a good dramatic note. So
Nick,
that's,
is,
yeah.
Is Crazy Train in Aeolian, is that a good example?
Yes, that's the perfect example because it has all of the notes in it. So Crazy Train. I often teach that one because it's a perfect example. And I say that because it has all of the notes within there. So there's your flat seven. Right? So when I'm talking about the things like flat six and flat seven, that's in relationship to the major scale. So we have, if you play major, like we'll go back to A for a second, and we give a number to each of these notes, it becomes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, octave, right? So that if we modify some of these things, first of all, it's minor, so it's flat three. Well, 1, 2, flat 3. Three becomes flat. To make it flat, it could go down a fret. So, okay, and then the other for Aeolian, you want flat six and flat seven. So six and seven was flat six, make it flat six, and then seven was here, and make it flat seven. So 1, 2, flat 3, 4, 5, flat 6, flat 7, 8. You don't have to be a great guitar singer to be a great guitar teacher, so that's a good thing. But that's
Melodyne for that stuff.
Yeah, exactly. That's right. Auto-tune. So that's the first one you want to check out. The next one is harmonic minor, and all we have to do with that.
It's one of my favorites.
Yeah, it's one of my favorites too. So that one you have to do the basically Aeolian, except you just raise the seventh or may play a natural seventh. So. So it's and that has more of a kind of a classical kind of sound. So if you're playing like that kind of that Yngwie Malmsteen. Yeah. So anyway, that's kind of that sort of sound. So a mode of that's very popular too is the Phrygian dominant. If you're playing from E, that's that. It kind of has a Egyptian desert kind of sound. The lead I always think of with that one is. We can play name that lead.
What? Yeah, that sounds familiar. Play it again.
Yeah. Okay, on and on.
Oh man.
So that's Dimebag Darrell Domination. So anyway, but
wow,
sorry,
cool.
that lick is a great example. Kind of like you mentioned with Crazy Train, of being a good example of. Yeah, it works great in metal. So that's Phrygian dominant. That's I think Joe Satriani coined that term. Basically, yeah, that's like or Phrygian major sometimes because it has this flat two and it's major.
So when you're talking about metal scales, Aeolian. It's like the fundamental. It's like it's a benchmark, right? And then when you alter it to turn it into harmonic minor, or you know, as we're discussing here, it's like adding a little bit of spice to it. It adds a little bit of spice to it, right? If you backed up Aeolian to like a Dorian scale or like a pentatonic scale, it's like Aeolian adds some spice to that. Harmonic minor adds some spice to that, and Phrygian dominant adds spice to Phrygian.
Yeah, totally. Totally.
What are some other styles of music that you hear harmonic minor or Phrygian dominant in? You mentioned obviously metal. You mentioned classical music, right? Mm-hmm. Yep. What about in Latin styles of music?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. You'll see it in Latin. You'll see it in jazz occasionally. I think the harmonic minor is a little less common than like jazz minor or melodic minor, which is where you have the sixth and the seventh raised, which I think if you start adding that, it becomes a little less metal for whatever reason. But absolutely the Latin kind of style. That's more, I don't really have that kind of tone right now, but that's more the... Mm-hmm. So, you know, when you're playing over, that's that, that basically it's a five chord minor, and that's where you get the, you know, that kind of thing, you know. Oh, sorry. You know, whatever. You're playing like, or like Santana or something like
Santana,
that.
Santana. That's what,
but, yeah, and I got on. one more spicy level for you. I got one, I said, I'm doing this thing on Facebook too, so I want to say hello to Brian Foster Allen. He's amazing. You know that guy? Amazing guitar player. You got Dimebag Soul. You got it.
Oh, cool.
Just saying hi real quick. Sorry. There we go.
Yeah, okay. Please do.
So the last one I want to mention, again, adding just a little bit more spice to the harmonic minor, is the Hungarian minor, which is basically harmonic minor with a sharp four. So you get this kind of sound. It's really
harmonic
cool.
These minor with a sharp four.
Yeah.
Okay. Wow.
Yeah, that's what's on. So it's got players like Ollie Hubert used to play that one while he was around, you know, RIP, you know, and let's see, it was Frederick Akison of Opeth likes that one. And it's a great, actually, yeah, just learning a lick by Marty Freeman that does that. And so it's a great, that's a great sound, very exotic. And it's, I think it's, if you understand Aeolian, as like you said, as a bass, that's like the place to start. You're going to be able to play tons of metal with that. And then harmonic minor for those kind of changes that pop up for Randy Rhoads and Yngwie Malmsteen and stuff like that. And then you could add this sort of, like you said, spice. It's kind of, you can think of it almost like mixing blues with it, you know? That sort of thing. So, that's
it. Dennis. Dennis Hello. Is saying, rock on. Good to see you.
Yes,
what's up,
thank
Dennis?
You. Thank
Good
you.
To hear you. Good to see you up there.
I think that covers the metal scales that I wanted to cover. So,
it looks like Alan's given us the raise the roof. Thanks for joining us, Alan.
Thank you. Thank you. Awesome. That's what my friend Brian here says. Nick, I love you.
What's up,
love
Fernando?
You too, man. Thanks yeah.
Thanks for joining, Escalda.
Yeah.
Cool, man.
So, okay. So, let's see. I can move on to the next one if you like.
Please do.
Okay. So, the next one, it's maybe a bit more advanced, but it is in the line of modes. And, I've been talking to JP a few times now. He's a big modal guy. So this is, I think you're going to really dig this one. So this one is requested by a really great music theorist online. His name's Neil Gardner. If you're not checking him out on Instagram, make sure to do it, because he has these napkin in music theory things. They're so cool. He's like, he'll sum up like harmonic cadences on a napkin. But it's
awesome.
Really good. So he asked for modal arpeggios. So modal arpeggios, for me, I think of them more as like 13 arpeggios. Now, what that means is when you take these scales that we're just working on, and I'm going to switch to this one. I will do a couple of them, but the idea is if we take our major scale, when we play arpeggios or chords, or broken chords, this is no way to think of arpeggios, we play every other note. So if we're going 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, we go 1, 3, 5, 7. And so that's what's called a major 7 arpeggio. And that's like the sound of the A major 7 or like A major sound. So modal arpeggios is when you do this, you keep going. So you get 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, 9. So you basically get 1, 3, 5, 7 and then 9, 11, 13 of that particular mode. And I'll work on singing it later, but that's the idea. So you get. So that was pretty cool. It's or you know, for me, I kind of think of it like it's you know, like a major 13 with 11 in there. Really, very major kind of sound. If we make it so we're talking about modal arpeggios. That one thing we could do is if we change it like a Lydian mode, right? So we could do sharp 4. So we take this note. That's the fourth one. So 1, 2, 3, 4. We do. I'm going to put it here, though, just for playability. But we get this. Oh, sorry. No. Give me a second to get my ear in there. But that's the idea. So. So it kind of. it's a cool way to play. And I think it's, for me, I just think of them as really extensions. Like, you know, a place to start before you kind of go full on mode here is maybe just adding, like, for instance, if you know your seventh arpeggios. With this lesson, I'm kind of assuming this is more, a little more advanced, so you know a major, like, seven. You can play. That's your ninth right there. So, you know, that's, you can start with it. Or, actually, with this one, let me give a quick exercise on this. I think additive practice on this is a really good idea. So, like, if I just go like this. So, additive practice is, I used to call this the monster exercise. I actually got the term additive practice from Rick Beato, another person definitely to check out on YouTube. But is the arpeggio is, so if I start with that. Of course, you could change it if you're looping it differently. Let's see. Of course, you hear me. I'm making a couple mistakes. If that happens, just slow it down a little bit. Just pull it off. So that's a good practice technique for something like that, especially if it's new. So that's kind of a major sound. Let me do, I'll do one minor sound too. So we're getting back to our metal scale. Maybe we'll do the Aeolian. So Aeolian is going to be something like this. So we have, again, that's one, flat three, five, flat seven, and then the ninth, the fourth, and the flat six. So no charge for mistakes. That's so anyway, that's so one thing I want to mention is this one I took sort of a parallel approach, which means that I compared modal arpeggios, you know, like for instance, like I did major, A major, A Lydian, A Aeolian. That's one way to approach this that I think is helpful with just hearing the sound of these things. You can also do these things diatonically. And for that, I won't get into that right here, but I do suggest checking out this lesson on YouTube of Rick Graham, and he runs through these. Just look up Rick Graham modal arpeggios, and he runs through the whole thing much better than I. So there's a good lesson on that there. But I wanted to show it in parallel, too, because you can practice it that way, too. So
Nick, you're
hey Greg,
you've got a shout out there.
Yeah, good to see you.
As these are coming in, I'm trying to ping them up there and see all the music. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
kind
thank you,
compliments.
Sir.
He's also a fantastic guitar player as well.
Nice.
Thanks for joining us tonight. This is so cool.
Yeah, right on.
So I'll have to remember to zoom in on you when you're playing those notes because they were going by so fast. Part of the reason I was keeping my guitar off is so you wouldn't hear any of the bad notes as I was trying to play with your playing.
No, I heard it. That's cool. And actually, it's worth noting that this format, Jason and I, we did a little test yesterday. We were able to actually kind of jam like in time. So if we get crazy enough, maybe we'll try it today because it worked. So usually there's a latency which you can't do it this way. But so maybe we'll give it a try if we get crazy.
And also, we've got a little live stream comment section. So I think as you're kicking in the comments, we'll be seeing them. So please ask questions as we go, and we'd be happy to. Answer them, and like I always say, if I don't know, I'll just make it up and sound confident. Otherwise, I'll throw it to Nick. And
sure. I got Facebook kind of here too. It's hi Travis. Travis Welk's an old buddy of mine. He does a lot of cool music videos during the quarantine right now. He's doing kind of some solo stuff, and that's pretty awesome.
That's awesome. Thanks, Becky.
Crossroads style, yeah.
All the guitar players.
Take it away, Jason. That wasn't nice. Yeah, sorry. That's me throwing Jason under the bus. Okay, so I had another question. Let's see. I think that was from Fava Blast, who's another great guitar player from Italy. He was asking about tasty chord progressions. That's tasty. For sure. Yeah, Paganini. So Yeah, so tasty chord progressions. So a couple of the ones that I like that I wanted to share. So one that I really like is and actually this is a chance to get into some, I mentioned that jazz minor modes aren't used that much in rock, and this is one that is. This is a Lydian dominant, and actually we were kind of jamming on it yesterday, Jason, but it's got this, let's see if I'm an F, it's the Simpsons mode.
Yeah,
it does, but it doesn't sound like that. So the progression was from a song that I wrote in an old band, and basically I'll play a little bit. I'll play just the progression. I'm going to do it in actually G sharp minor, but it goes. So anyway, that's it.
Wow.
So the progression, what's happening there, and I'll explain a little bit. I had a lesson on this on my, this is the promotion part. It's self-promotion. You're clear for landing.
Yeah, let's hear it.
Steellemon.com, there's a lesson on this there. Okay, so lesson is this. We're playing G-sharp minor. And again, it's just like one fret down from A minor. So don't be too scared if not Mr. Music Theory. In general. So anyway, so that it's got this chord. And it goes to basically E7. And what you notice there is that you get that blues note. That so. So that's a flat six dominant seventh chord. So you get this, you know, it's this great sound, and the sound that you get from the scale, what happens is you get rid of the fifth of the G sharp minor scale. Because that's not the right sound. So you get this up. It's this really rad sound. So you get that really briefly in there, and
it's got a little bit of a dissonance to it, which gives it this cool sort of flavor. It wants to get a resolution. Your ears want to hear a resolution, but you may or may not get it.
Yeah, totally, totally. It's a great sound. The Hammer's Helmet, it's good. So anyway, that's a lesson. That's one too that Marty Friedman talks about. I think he goes over that in his DVD. He's doing an A minor. I forget, maybe it's the song Dragon's Kiss does that. I'm trying to think. But he does run through that too. So that's a really cool one. And you can get into that very easy, but just playing the blues note, you know.
So it's that.
Yeah, that's on that chord. Because it's basically the flat seven of your E7. Sorry. Yeah, that's it. And you can get more of the. Yeah, that's the ticket. You get more of that modal sound if you just add some of the other notes from basically G sharp minor or G sharp Aeolian, but just leaving out the fifth, because that's not a note that you want that particular chord. You just leave that one out. This one, which is you get the flat sharp 11 on that chord. So anyway, that's one of the progressions I wanted to share. Let's see. I think let me see if I can pull this other one. I got this. I didn't get a chance to look at this before. What was it? Okay, here's the chain. Okay, so.
That's
a song that that I kind of wrote for some friends of mine. I had a friend who just texted me one time. My friend Joe was like, "Hey, let's write this metal song. It's metal as AF." You know, I was like, "Okay." So I wrote this song called Metal AF. And what's cool about that, or what I was really proud of that, is that I had these weird modulations. So it's kind of an E sort of song. It's got Slayer riffs like. That sort of that kind of thing. And the key signature change, it goes to C minor and then B flat minor, and then somehow I made it go back to E minor. So that's kind of cycle. I transition with a flat two chord. That's how I get to the next. that flat two chord is the five chord of the E. So that was one that I was like, God, I can't believe I made that work. And you know, it's because
it
cool. Yeah. Thanks. So that would be a tasty chord progression, tasty morsel for my friend Faba Blast in Italy. So,
yeah, I agree with that one.
Yeah.
Very tasty. Cool stuff.
All I'd say, I got a shout out for the solo in Our Sky. Still one of my favorites from my friend Andrew. Andrew and I go way back. I've known Andrew for 35 years, something like that. So, yeah, I could try Andrew's this little request, and I'll try to do a little bit of Our Sky. So, I guess. Something like that.
Wow.
I haven't played that solo in a few years. A little rusty, but it's something. And it's, let's see, I'm trying to remember that rhythm. It was like. It's something like that kind of thing. Yeah, it kind of climbs up the scale. Yeah, that's it. Yeah, that's it, man. And it hits that five chord too, so you can do all the.
I was gonna say, so it sounds like it was in a harmonic minor sort of mode. It's right in line with what you're describing.
Yeah, totally. I just throw in diminished arpeggios when I don't know what to do over that. You know, it works well. That was one that I recorded with a band called Cimarron. It's a song called Our Sky. So.
Oh, cool.
But so that's kind of the scales and arpeggios section. So there's a few other little things here we can get into. I'll go like this here. And a couple practicing questions about building speed. So we can get into building speed. Particularly, he's asking about Marty Friedman and Jeff Loomis. I'll admit, I haven't done a lot of Jeff Loomis stuff. I'm a fan. I think he's absolutely incredible. I've done some Marty Friedman stuff, so I can kind of approach it that way. You might have to practice with me. I haven't done any of this stuff in a while, but in terms of building speed, I think one of the things that Marty Friedman does is he'll take a small pattern and he'll loop it and then create lots of different variations on that. So he'll take one of the things that he does is kind of cool is he takes these arpeggios. So slowly. He's got this little reverse sweep, which is up, up. And then a little. So like that kind of. That's sort of that. Now I'm starting to sound. It sounds a little bit like Tosin Abasi or something. So that's a variation. Then you might. So I think in terms of like building speed, in terms of Marty Friedman kind of stuff, that works. And you can move there. Something like that, where you move it through a bunch of different arpeggios. So in terms of building speed, this is something that I think there's kind of two sort of schools of thought right now. And the one is tried and true. It's slowing things down and I'll raise this to talk at the mic. And breaking it down and really making sure that it's nice and accurate and then building up the speed gradually. That's tried and true. You've heard that from many, many people. It does work. And there's sort of, I would call a newer school of thought, which is to start fast. which is not how
it's a little more fun.
It is fun. Yeah. And the idea being I'm making sure I get this guy's name right. Troy Grady, the cracking the code guy. That's either the basketball player. I'm not sure if I'm getting the guy's name right, but the cracking the code guy, he basically says like, if you're, you know, doing this, you know, tapping the table, you know, let's see if I can see me there. You can do that motion. If you can knock on a door, it's kind of the same sort of thing. So the idea is that you don't want to make any bad habits at a slow tempo, so that when you notch it up and you start to get 120, 130, 140 on those 16th notes, you run into problems. So that's something that you can try. What I advise is whatever you're trying to learn and play, whether it's Marty Friedman, Jeff Loomis, whatever, is to try to find a tempo that you can play it at accurately so that you can just play it. And in terms of the technique kind of thing, in terms of like not building bad habits, the important thing there is that if you're trying to build speed, you need to push your limits. You need to push that boundary every once in a while. So I kind of like it like this. Like, and actually, I want to make one thing clear too, that people who are saying start fast, they're not saying play fast and sloppy. Of course, they're not saying that. You know, it's you want to be, you know, accurate, and that's I think most people. I mean, there's no follow this rule of thumb every time, but in general, we want to be accurate. So I guess what I'm saying is, you know, there's a couple different ways to do it, but that's what I recommend, is to slow things down. And so like something like that, I might get out a metronome and just work on it. And the way I look at it too, is if let's say your goal tempo is 160 and you are able to get this at 80, which is like half, that's 80, you know, clicks per beat, you know, beats per minute. You have it and you have something that you can measure. Sorry, I'm going to plug in my phone here. My Facebook comments happen. You have something you can measure. And the way I describe it to my students is like, you have it. Now it's woodshedding. It's practice. So that's an important point too. And I think that always playing a fast, I think it works for some people. I think that a couple people have come to mind, Andy Wood, Andy James, obviously the cracking the code guy. So I'd be interested to hear if anybody on here comment wise, learned that way, learned to play fast. And the whole thing, they're focusing on like being really smooth, you know, so you're focusing on just basically like something very simple like this, where you're, you know, just being very relaxed about it and have it be natural. But like I said, for me, whatever the thing is, let's see if I was doing something like that. No. So that's kind of sloppy. So what I might do is get, you know, I'll just tap it on my foot, but you know, now when I have that, you know, it's like, okay. What one thing I like about, you know, moving up like that is that you can quantify it, which means that you can measure it. So I got
by the
it.
Way,
yeah.
By the way, was that Nuno? Was that extreme?
Oh, no. That would be Mozart.
It reminds me of Do You Want to Play from Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure, yeah. Right at the beginning. I think you ripped off part of that lick, right?
Yeah,
Nuno.
Totally. Oh, yeah, totally. Yeah. No, it's great. Yeah, I think you're right.
Listen to it. Bill and Ted, man.
They got a third movie coming out. You believe it? They got those guys back for one more.
Yeah, man.
What happened to Wild Stallions is what it's called, or something. Yeah,
it was a great. That was a great sort of rock.
Oh, okay, well, hold on. So, if we're talking about Wild Stallions, sorry, you go.
Yep.
I'm sorry.
I was going to ask you a quick question. So going back to the basics on the speed thing. So you mentioned this, but I think it's important. Well, maybe it is, maybe it isn't. But metronome, right? You mentioned that sort of in passing. What I find is metronome for me, especially when so I produce and create music, and I'm constantly recording to a metronome, so that it's very easy for me to do. But I also practice that way too, and that's one way to track your progress on speed. So. If you're not playing with a metronome, maybe give it a shot and see how that works with your practice style. But it certainly was helpful for me, and it sounds like it's helpful for you as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's some people are kind of anti-metronome, and I think, you know, I think to a certain extent, you want to turn it off sometimes to see where your feel is, you know, because there's a natural ebb and flow when people play together. Sure. So there's something to be said about that. But I think that in general, it's a good idea for timekeeping and keeping yourself kind of honest with certain things. Cause it's like, you could be like, oh, I'm amazing at this run. And then you start playing into something in time and ooh, wait a second, maybe not, you know? So that, I tend to be somebody who's like, yes, practice with the metronome.
Let me ask you another thing on that. One other point, sweep picking versus alternate picking versus a combination. Where are you with those sort of picking, leveraging picking techniques to aid your speed?
Yeah, I think they sound different. They have different effects. So, people tend to be naturally inclined one way or the other. Like a lot of people are like, you know, picking alternate picking versus legato, for instance. I think it's good to work on all these things. It depends on one's goals, of course. But, I think there's value in, you know, picking arpeggios. Like, for instance, I was going before with that arpeggios. Now I'll move it up to, actually, I had my friend Rod, he said, one request for today. He said, play something in B. So I'm going to move this up to B. There you go, Rod.
In B, okay.
Yeah, that's right. So B major, we'll do B major 7. So, let's see what I got. Okay, so that'd be more of a sweeping approach, which is like very smooth versus or Steve Morris with, you know, that's very much more defined, you know, versus I'm not saying it that well, but you get the idea. It's a different effect. And I think certain passages will sound better with certain techniques. So it's just worth experimenting and see what works for a lot of people.
I agree. It's like different tools in your toolbox. So explore them. If you're interested, go in, dive in. But they're all ways to kind of get you to similar places.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think it's, you know, for me, like I still struggle with economy picking, you know, single note lines. That's something that's just, I have to constantly work at just to get a little bit better. And one of these days I'll be able to do that really well. But it's like, for me, it's just easier to just do, just alternate pick it or like a versus, usually I'm kind of,
that's funny. I learned the mode sort of the Frank Gambale style, so sweep picking technique. So at the same time I'm learning the modes, I'm learning to pick them in a sweep pattern. And then it can be limiting too, because you should learn them in a number of different ways. You should pick them in a number of different ways. But that was a great way for me to learn the concept of sweep picking. At the same time, I was learning, I was building both abilities at the same time.
Yeah, totally. Totally. It's a great technique. And actually, I think that it's worth mentioning too, that Gambale, because he makes some pretty bold statements, but he says, he abandons, this is a pretty good shape, this kind of classic shape. But he's like, but this works a little bit better because you have this, sweeping motion you can do with just changing one note. And I think it's worth noting that he knows both ways. This is weird. Yeah. I think it's partly driven by clickbait, but on YouTube, things like caged versus 3 notes per string. And it's just, it makes me laugh because it's like, you don't have to pick just one. They're both are really, really useful, that's a good example is it's just useful for different things and they sound different. It's like Zach Wild talks about, like specifically when you're talking about the alternate picking versus legato, he talks about alternate picking being kind of meat and potatoes. A lot of pick kind of sound versus that really smooth,
Zach Wild is awesome.
Totally. Yeah. So it's a good point. So I think it's just developing each technique on its own I'm kind of different places with each. For me, I kind of developed as a legato player before my picking came along. Mm-hmm. And I was very much, and actually the first way I picked for the first couple of years was all downstroke. And I remember I learned that Kirk Hammett's old Fade to Black, all downstrokes. Yeah. It wasn't too fast, I'm sorry. the whole way, you know, and it worked. It wasn't too fast, but eventually I was like, well, maybe I should try some upstrokes, and you know, and so I, you know, I just that's how you do it, you know, just one thing at a time, and you just, you know, stick with it.
Yeah.
So
what are, do you have a, were there some other questions from?
Yes. Okay. So, so one in particular was very interesting. I had a friend of mine, Rasgriz Ace, and we've kind of become buddies on Instagram. And he was saying, he kind of had a lot to say about this, but I'll kind of try to break it down. Is basically you want to, like, self-evaluation of one's own playing, you know, and how to break down certain elements when playing and making sure that it's you know, we're breaking down certain passages. So, and correcting those as we go. Hold on a second, I'm sorry. Turn my volume. Okay. So I think it's the way he was talking about it is like somebody who's playing maybe doesn't realize that they're not playing with good rhythm, or that they're playing maybe two bends that are out of tune, you know, something like that. So I think that, you know, with I think it's important to have self-evaluation in one's playing. In other words, to kind of look at your own playing from time to time. And it's easier than ever now with, I mean, most everybody watching this has a phone or a computer that you can record yourself with. And I think that's a good idea every once in a while. It can be very humbling for somebody who's just starting. I remember the first time I recorded myself, I was like, if my sister Rayanne's watching, I tried to record the national anthem on guitar. It was like one of the first things I tried to record. And it was terrible. Yeah. Yeah, I should have had Jason there. He could have done it for you. It would have been amazing. But I was like a week into my playing. I couldn't do it. And it was, and I listened back and I was like, oh my, this is so bad. But that's an important, I mean, I think it's important to have confidence oneself, not saying it, but it's, I think it's a crucial thing to listen to your playing and be honest with yourself about what needs work. And that's a tough thing to do every once in a while. But, you know, it just, I think every once in a while with a certain passage you're working on, you could record it, you know, one time, a couple of weeks later, record it again and see the progress of it. You know, and it reminds me actually, if anybody hasn't been watching the Steve Vai Alien Love Guitar Secrets on YouTube, make sure to do it because it's incredible. It reminds me of this because he talks about the various stages you go through in terms of mastery. And there's this first stage where he's talking about, I'm not crazy about the terminology, but it's unconscious, see if I get this right, unconscious incompetence. In other words, you don't know what you don't know. You don't realize that you're playing out of tune. Your bends are out of tune. You don't realize that. So with self kind of checking out your playing and really listening carefully and, you know, so forth, you can start to come and realize that I'm not very good at this. This doesn't sound very good. That would be conscious incompetence. In other words, I know I don't know how to do this. The third stage of that is conscious competence. So you can think about it and get this thing to happen after much practice. And then eventually mastery would be unconscious competence, which means that you have it completely mastered and you don't have to think about it. You know, it's kind of like, you know, something like with picking. We're talking about picking. For a lot of people, I'm picking just one string. Just, you know. I don't have to work. I'm not, you know, I do this all day and drink water, you know, it's just something I can do. So, you know, but that's an important lesson. And I think one other thing too, is having people that, you know, and trust, like a guitar teacher, or somebody that you're, you know, maybe, can get an honest opinion from, on Instagram or Facebook, or whatever. 'Cause a lot of people are like, yeah, man, great job. Or sorry. But you know, it's the truth is that happens a lot when people aren't necessarily playing all that well. It still happens, you know. It's, you know, so I think that's an important thing. So in terms of how to actually, so like if it's a problem with a playing thing, one of the things that is very good idea is to, and actually this is basic practice routine for like any piece of music that you're playing. So I'll take the Mozart thing since I kind of knew it. I do that as a warm up too, or let's call it the Bill and Ted. And actually, JP, I want to make sure we do a righteous harmony. We can't just talk about Bill and Ted and not go in a harmony. You know, we got to make that face too. Okay.
Three. Or the old.
Okay, I don't know. All right, so, yeah, Okay, so I messed up there. So I'm going to try. So that's a little piece we'll take. Let's say I'm working on that, and I realize that. And so when you practice a piece of music, the first thing that you want to do is play through the entire piece. And in this case, I'm making it shorter just for the purposes of this. But play through it, warts and all, even spots you don't know as well, just kind of work your way through it. This is a John Finn kind of method. I learned that from my guitar.
So this is to basically bake it into your memory. Get it in so that you know what you need to play.
Yes.
And then it's refining it so it becomes muscle memory. Is that right?
That's right. And really the purpose of it is what you just said, is to find out the spots that need work. And then to isolate those spots. This is a crucial component of this is... like for me, I think it was here. So right there, you heard it. There's a mistake. So that would be the spot I would isolate. So if I'm isolating this, I might slow it down. So isolating, I can do a couple things. Slowing it down, like I said, I always, that just helps. If you have it, if you get... I play that at a slow tempo, but I have it. Now I have it in my grasp, and I'm not playing with a metronome, but I would typically do that, and I can measure that and get it up to whatever tempo I need. I can also practice in bursts. So it's not quite there. Oh, man. So a good demonstration of me practicing. But that's the purpose of that. So let me just do that a bit. Okay, so the idea is you work on all these little spots that are in the piece, and then once you kind of work on these little spots, you put them back into the piece, play the whole thing from beginning to end. And it's kind of a lather, rinse, repeat sort of thing. So if I... Okay, so I got to work on a little bit more, but you get the idea. That's one thing that really works well, is to isolate those little difficulties and be honest about what it's, because I think that the tendency is like to play the spots that are really, really good. It's like with guitar teaching, I see this all the time. It's like when I, every once in a while, you got to teach. If guitar teachers out there watching this, if Greg Rappaport's still watching, it's in every guitar book. So every once in a while it comes up. Guitar students they're pretty good at the first line. The second line goes pretty well until the end because it's different. And then the third line's a disaster because they play it from beginning to end, beginning to end, beginning to end. And they don't realize that the third section's, that B section is not there. So you need to focus on that, just that B section in practice time. So in practice time, you play through the whole piece.
That's a really good point.
Yeah, so you work on that section so it's just as comfortable as the other ones. So it just feels, like I said, comfortable, and you can just do it. So that's a couple strategies. The other thing that you can do is create little variations on that. That's a really great example too. So if I'm doing, I'm gonna do that harmonic minor thing. I'll see if I can do that. Just move it around to different positions like that. That's the thing that you can do. So, let's see. Something like that. That's a fun way to kind of do it. And sort of get this technique into your system. So, the idea is that if it's a, let's say it's a, we'll go back to the Marty Freeman thing. If I'm doing, so this thing, that's it. Something like that. Move it through a scale and move it around a little bit so that I get a little bit of practice on it, and kind of mess around with just that one little technique that is in whatever piece I'm working on. So, and that also breaks up the monotony a little bit, because like you said, JP, you're working on some of your muscle memory within the piece, which is crucial. But I think that working on the same piece, and if anybody's ever done that for hours and hours, it's like banging your head against the wall, so you can still work on the same mechanics or whatever the thing you're working on, but in, create other situations or create little etudes, little studies,
So, I'd like to add to that. First of all, great, great suggestions. Again, sort of metronome, trusting, recording, record yourself and listen to it, right? Listen to it back and be honest and know that it's just like push-ups. You can only do a bunch, you know, handful of them to start out, but you're gonna get better. And third, find someone who you can trust, who's gonna give you honest feedback in a way that is helpful to you, in a way that is constructive, in a way that you trust and value their input, and you'll go back and do it. But guess what? Your ears are likely gonna tell you right out of the gate where you are with that practice, with that piece. So trust them. And the other thing I'll add is, it's got to be fun. Make it fun. Mm-hmm. Make it fun. If, you know, some purist will say, you got to practice totally clean, totally slow, work your way up. Do whatever is fun that's going to keep you in the game of practicing. Yeah. Do whatever you want. But my suggestion is, if you just crank the amp, turn up the distortion, do whatever you want, but make it fun so that you spend the time doing it. Now, the other thing that I've found is you'll be hammering through something and then hitting your head against the wall. Nick, tell me if this happens to you.
Yes.
And you just hours and hours. And then the next day you come down, you throw on your guitar and you start playing. And all of a sudden things are somehow easier that day. Something goes on in your subconscious that kind of locks stuff up. It's almost like your brain kind of helps you out when you're not actually playing, and it enables you to push through some things. So
that is like the universal experience of learning to sweep pick, by the way. That is learning to sweep pick right there. For most people, I think some people, they get it right away and we don't like them.
It clicks. For others, it takes some time. It takes some time. No, all of a sudden, it clicks, and it's like you're riding a bike. You're like, I'm riding a bike.
This it's like, great. Oh, this is so awkward. This is so awkward. This is so awkward. And then, you know, you come back the next day, and you're blazing. I mean, that's very, very common to have that kind of experience. You're right. It's something about, you know, you're all of a sudden your neurons go, oh, okay, I know what I'm supposed to do here, you know.
And celebrate the small victories along the way. When you first start, you can't play any of it. But within 10 minutes, you've got the first part. That's a small victory. Get excited about it, because guess what? You're going to know the whole thing if you just keep going through it. So if you can get excited about those small victories, and as you're growing and growing, eventually it just locks into muscle memory. Half of the things that we're playing when we're not really thinking about stuff is just you're blowing through all kinds of stuff. It's like muscle. If you had to slow it down, sometimes I have trouble just playing the notes slowly because I'm like, I don't know what I just played.
There are certain patterns that lend themselves to playing fast, and you slow them down. Well, what the heck? What is that? You know, and that's very common as well. That's, that's I think, by the way, that the approach of learning to play fast first, that's also very common with that. So it's anyway, there's all kinds of interesting things there. But very good points. And I think that keeping it fun for me, I just have a glutton for punishment for that kind of thing. I was doing that Steve Vai thing yesterday. I was loving every minute of it. All the 1, 2, 3, 4 stuff. And Levi Clay's, he just, you know, I could tell, man, he's doing this. He's like, this is just torture. You know, he just had to go into Blues Jam, you know, 30 minutes in for just a minute, just 30 seconds, just to kind of cleanse himself of the 1, 2, 3, 4s.
Good point.
But you know, for me, I think that I can get deep into those things. But again, you're right. I think it's important to keep that element of fun. It's there's another great DVD to check out is the Eric Johnson. I think it's the second one that he did. I bought the tape, bought it for $80, that 2-tape set. You know, now it's probably on YouTube for free. I don't know. But he talks about, he likes to have an element of fun in everything he's practicing. And I think that's, you know, it shouldn't be it's not supposed to be work, it's supposed to be fun. So, but it's kind of, so creating, you know, I like what you said. It's like, you can make it fun. That's why I say creating variations and creating little etudes, you know, that work on these things, like the John Petrucci Rock This One's a great example. Something like that little etude does it. Sorry, I'm playing like crap. But you get that, you go through that whole sequence. But he does this whole sequence of chords that works on, it's basically string skipping. So that's a string skipping etude. It's not just, you know, some boring exercise, you know, it's, you know, it wouldn't be just, you know,
meaningless. It sounds pleasing. It's fun.
Yeah.
To play.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. Exactly. You get something that's musical afterwards. And I think the other thing that nice thing that happens with that too, is that you start to create your own stuff automatically from it. So, you know, regardless, okay, I can play Mozart. Cool. That's cool. But when I start to, you know, go to play something with JP, I got these things I can draw on. I can do this stuff in my own voice. You know, I can do it my own way with my own notes, my own phrasing. And so anyway, he had quite a few things to say about that. But I think that, and like you said, having a trusted friend or somebody just said, what do you think of my playing? And, you know, I get that every once in a while from a few people. I say, okay, try this and, you know, whatever. And you take everything with a grain of salt and you know, trust yourself. But that can be very helpful to hear somebody say, well, you know, those bands could be more in tune, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, that's my buddy who requested our guy. He's like, you know, maybe try a different, vary your vibrato. I was like, good suggestion. He's a great singer. He's in a vocal group, men's group, and they did Carnegie Hall. So I'm like, okay, I gotta listen to this guy about vibrato, you know, because that's what I'm trying to emulate, is that. So Andrew, if you're still watching, I heard you, buddy. So
trying to stay motivated, trying to not be dissuaded from practicing, being able to take critiques, I think is such a great skill set, and always consider the source too.
Yeah.
Sometimes you everyone's got an opinion. Sometimes you hear the opinion, consider the source, and say, I'm not sure that's fully applicable to what I'm trying to do.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
Okay, thanks for that. And then sometimes, I hadn't thought of that. You know, I'll put that into action. But being able to constantly improve—that's what this game potentially is about. If you want to, yeah. And that's about making refinements along the way.
Yeah, absolutely. I enjoy that. That's a fun thing for me. I play with a lot of guys who are just they got their thing. And that's what they want to do. And that's fine. And that is not me. I always try to push the next thing serve. I was kind of talking about writing my own music, you know, kind of serve the music, of course. I'm not going to be like, okay, we're going to do something ridiculous here. But I try to throw in things that I'm working on and push myself that way, because that helps. So
makes it fun.
Yeah, totally.
What other questions do we have?
So that was kind of the practicing portion of that. That is the next section. You're doing it right now. Is the soloing / improv section. Yeah. We'll have to do that both. Oh, great lick from that Yngwie. How's that go? That's a lick from the Levi Clay thing yesterday. I forget who was playing, but it's a. little sauce there. Yeah. So you can kind of jam. That's awesome.
It's a little bit garbled when we're playing at the same time, but it still sounds pretty cool.
Yeah. So hopefully, mine is, you're getting cut out a little bit, but I'm here. He's, I mean,
there's a couple little things poking through.
He's got the goods.
this guy.
Yeah, I got to point the other way. Okay, so I had a few questions about soloing and improvisation. So one of them was I had a request to kind of take 3-4 chords, what a chord progression, and to improv with variety, how to keep it kind of fresh as you're improvising something. So I think that I have a few, I think what that comes down to is a base, like if I had to sum it up, what would be strategies. You want to cultivate different ideas and options and strategies for soloing. So I think that there's one level when you first start, which is like, if you're like what we were just doing there, we're kind of doing an A mixo thing, but if we simplify it, you can just do, you know, A minor pentatonic, just A5, right? You play really anything over that, but as a starting point, most people play, okay, it's A5, I play A minor pentatonic. Maybe a blues scale. Okay, so, That's very much a starting point. That's kind of like everybody, I think a lot of people start with, okay, just blast the scale over the whole thing, which that's, you know, which is fine. You know, there's that works. That sometimes that's what it's called for. But if you can cultivate a few different ideas, you know, it's so start to think about things like space, you know? So if I'm playing, you know, you know, so just leaving some holes in there, you know, it's like as guitar players, we have to remember to breathe in our playing because I can just go like this and do the whole podcast while I'm playing notes, right, Jason?
I like to look at it. I like to look at it also. Depends. It all depends. So if you have a certain time, if you have an amount of time allocated to you where you're given a solo, then it's kind of like it's a bit of a race, right? You don't want to blast right out of the gate full speed. Maybe you do. Maybe you do. One strategy is instead of blasting out of the gate full speed, you come in and it's all in what you want to do. What I like to do is kind of tell a story. I like to just give you a little bit of something. I like to build it up. I like to, by the end of it, give you a crescendo and then something kind of like, you know, fireworks going off. Yep. But if you hit them with the ending fireworks right up front, then you don't have anything to really, it's all downhill from there,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, it's pacing. And actually, what you're getting into there is another question that was asked by Jay Ruby on Instagram as well, structuring a solo. And I was literally going to say basically a lot of what you just said. It's just, you know, telling a story, pacing yourself. You know, it's, I mean, not to be too crude, but not blowing your wad all at once, you know, your mm-hmm. wad all at once. It's, you know, it's leaving a place for it to go, developing themes, you know? So, but yes, absolutely. I agree. And that's such a good point about the different times. I mean, sometimes it's a 2-beat fill, get in and get out, play one note, whatever it is. Sometimes it's 8 measures. Sometimes, you know, sometimes it's Freebird, you know, so, and everything in between. So those are going to require, different strategies. But yeah, so I mean, there's all kinds. I mean, there's rhythmic variety is another one. I think a lot of people when they start out, they like this one. Enough with the diddly deets. You know, use them. You know, you can do whatever you want, but it's like if you maybe play a quarter note in there, you know. All of a sudden, it kind of has some meaning, you know, that has more emphasis on that one as opposed to just doing one thing all the time, you know. So that's kind of a basic one, but I've heard that before. I went to a guitar center, guitar shredder contest. It was 2 minutes of that, and I just by the end, I almost fell over laughing because he just does that one lick. He's moving it everywhere, you know. So I mean, sorry, I'm not trying to demean anybody, but it was just that one thing just got humorous after 2 minutes straight. But
well,
so,
you know, it all depends on what you're trying to do. I mean, if you've got, just four bars and your job is to make somebody go, holy cow, mm-hmm. wow, that guy's impressive, then okay. Now, if you're trying to tell a story, if you're trying to create a melody, if you're trying to get something that somebody's going to hum, something yeah. that they're actually going to remember. A million notes makes it difficult to remember. Yeah. Sometimes it's as simple as just one note, one articulation. I mean, yeah. that was a flavor in just basically two notes.
Yeah, yeah.
then now I've told you something else. Mm-hmm. And then maybe I tell you what I told you. Tell you something new. Then maybe I want to go into something a little bit more. And I'm really not doing too much. I'm just giving you just little, outside of a couple of bad chords there that I fix at the end.
No, but man,
you don't have to have a lot of notes, even in a pentatonic. If you only, audition some of those notes over the chords and then just play with them. Don't. Sometimes it's just about the note. Maybe it's two notes. Make sure you hit the bend.
Yep.
Skip some notes. But you could make just a simple pentatonic scale sound just sang and beautiful, or you could blaze through it, or you could do both.
Yeah, no, that was brilliant. Fantastic. Yeah, there's so many points in there to take away. So, yeah, absolutely. I agree with all that. And that was a wonderful story. I'll play this back and be like, what did he do there? That was really good. I'm going to steal that. So, fantastic. I mean, things like just a kind of like phrasing, you know, that's like your phrasing was awesome. That's part of what sold that. And that's one of the lessons I give to a student about the first in blues, you know, because in terms of phrasing, you know, I say, okay, and now let's play a whole note over it. It's, you know, and then, you know, just that slide and the vibrato, that's the stuff that makes it come alive. And what you just played was very rich in a lot of those tens, a lot of stuff going in there, even though it's, you know, simple and unconsciously competent at this point, I'd say for you. But it's, you know, that kind of stuff really, really makes a big difference for sure.
Yeah, cool. Man. We got some kind feedback from Greg here.
Yeah.
Cool, man.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Greg's a monster. Do you want to check him out on Instagram? He has amazing guitar lessons. He does this cool thing in his lessons where he goes, okay, here's the lick, slow, and then medium, and then blazing. And then immediately goes into a jam session where he demonstrates it, improvises, and demonstrates. It's so cool. And it's just practicality defined. I just absolutely love it. I love Greg's playing. Amazing stuff.
That's
so
awesome.
Yeah.
To check him out.
Yeah, for sure. Definitely follow him. He's great. So yeah, actually, like I said, that got into a lot of stuff, structuring a solo. Basically, you just kind of covered that pretty much. You know, I think, like I said, my main idea is to have different strategies for that. And another thing too, that's really important is to analyze some of your own favorite solos. So, you know, listen with a critical ear of, okay, I really like this solo. How does it start? Does it build? Does it blast off right away? You know, so, you know, that's, I think it's just getting yourself to think about soloing and improvising in a different way. The other thing I want to circle back to is your point about, you know, playing melodically. I like the term, you know, this is an idea of balancing speed with lyricism. You know, that's and there's kind of a balance of that, how much you're kind of like, if you're talking about like playing fast before, you know, the fast blazing stuff versus melodicism, you know, and how much that like one play I really like for that is Jason Hook of Five Finger Death Punch. I think his solos they're always so well balanced with melodicism and shredding. Every one, I'm just like, most of the time, you know, not to bash the band too much, but I kind of just, when I get through the song, I get to the solo. That's the part that I want to hear, you know? And I like songs. They're awesome. There's a few songs. Yeah. I really dig what they do, but.
I don't know why Yngwie's Rising Force came to mind when you said that. I first hearing that album going like, oh my gosh, there's a singer. Like, when is this over?
So the vocals are just a waste of time between solos. Is that the joke?
Yeah.
But anyway, so, and the other point is, you know, another book I'll reference is The Speed Mechanics for Lead Guitar. It's the Troy Stetna. It's a big influence on me. And I was reading some of the stuff that, because he's got all kinds of lessons on this too. And actually, that's a book I'll recommend for a lot of the practicing stuff too. That's where I learned a lot of that stuff of isolating and creating variations and things. But he talks about when you're blazing a scale, it's more like, you know, if you think about like John Coltrane, you know, Walls of Sound, you know, that's more, you're making more of an impression when you're doing something like, you know, if you're playing, you know, like that, you know, the, you know, that's blazing scales, but then, you know, playing that versus playing a melody, something like that, you know, it's like I said, so it's that balance between those things. It's kind of like, you know, when you're doing the like scale runs like that, it's kind of like putting the whole thing right there, you know, for you to hear versus kind of like picking a little, I like to call them note sets. Like, for instance, like you were kind of working with, you know, just those three notes. And what can you do? You know, that kind of thing where it's, you know, what can you do with that? You sit with that. What can you express with that? And it gives you a place to go melodically, you know? So, anyway.
Yeah. Believe it or not, you don't need a lot of notes to come up with something just beautifully awesome. And in fact, I've found that a lot of times in life and in creativity, the constraints, oh my gosh, I can't do this. Mm-hmm. Those constraints can actually, be a breeding ground for wonderful creativity.
Oh,
so
totally, yeah. Yep,
so
absolutely. Yeah.
Forcing constraints on yourself sometimes is an interesting way of doing it.
It's funny because as a teacher, I used to use words like constraints or limitation, like with improvisation. Okay, limit yourself to just the minor pentatonic scale, whatever. And inevitably, my students they would rebel. They just rebel. They don't. It's like guitar players don't want to hear that. So I like the term parameters. You add parameters.
Oh, that's great.
Because
first
of all, I wanted to avoid resistance from my students because I'm trying to, because the idea is like when I say just use minor pentatonic for this, of course, when you improvise, use whatever you want. But we want to learn to use these set of notes and how to actually use these.
Yeah.
And if you find other notes, that's a happy mistake. That's great. We'll explore those. We'll talk about those. But that's parameters, or like you said, it's if you have a, you know, constraint or I forget what you said there, but that kind of thing, that can be, you know, like you said, you have to work within those. You have to work with what you got, you know, and that can create awesome stuff for sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
So let's see. Okay. So that kind of covers the improvising with variety as well as structuring a solo. That was great. Thank you, JP, covering that.
Yeah.
And then the last question there was the how to apply scales and arpeggios over chord progressions. So it's kind of a how to play scales over chords kind of question. And, you know, that's a pretty broad question. But what I would say is that it's important to learn how to play, you know, if you don't have a chord progressions, even just over one chord. That's a suggestion I'll make for as a practice is, you know, figure out what you can play over, you know, just G major. You know, it's if you're playing, you know, this. You know, obviously, power chord, you can play whatever. But if you start with, okay, you know, let's say we're playing, let's take it with major, do a major pentatonic. You know? Yeah, so that, like I said, that's getting more into like chord progressions, you know, like more like chord progressions, but even like just one chord, you know, if it's just, you know. Okay, so on and on. So I threw a little Hendrix thing there, but you know, it's okay, that's how I can use that over that one chord. So that when the G comes in that situation, it's not like, oh, crap, on to the B, R, C, and D, and oh, I got that flat six dominant seventh chord that he suggested me trying to play. That's, you know, it gets to be a lot of stuff. You know, you just take one sound and sit with it a little bit. And you can do different strategies than that, too. So, like, you know, if we're talking about G major, you know, we were talking about Lydian. We like playing, you know, Lydian. Or maybe, you know, so learning how to play
P.
Yeah, right. Yeah. or the Zeppelin cover. Yeah, it's awesome.
Yeah. Oh, that's right. That is an original.
But they did it so well. Like those guys, that they just crushed it. Awesome. Yeah. Awesome. But anyway, so that's the suggestion I make. And actually, the point I want to make with that too is, there's like three basic sounds that you want to learn to do this with. And that would be major, minor, and dominant. And
I was just going to say that. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's, if there's other sounds too, there's things like suspended chords you know, certain augmented things, but really a lot of those things kind of fall under dominant, you know, and certain, like if you're talking about, we were talking about the modes earlier, you know, if you're talking about your minor modes that come from the major scale, you're talking about, basically Dorian, Aeolian, and Phrygian. And you can, you know, I love Jason's term, audition these scales over these things. I love that. And, you know, note by note, you can do this. So, and I strongly suggest you do that, so you kind of get a sense of what these things sound like on their own before you start going, okay, here's four chords that I have to play over. And, you know, that tried and true, you know, the scale over the whole thing and, you know, different strategies, because it gets to be a lot to kind of handle. But if you know how, if you know how to like play that, you'll know how to resolve it. You know, so that's the thing you can work on. So if I'm playing like a Dorian thing, let's say over, you know, that kind of thing, you know. You know, resolving, and not that you have to resolve on the root, you can work on different target tones. You know, you can resolve to different chord tones, you know. You know, that's fine. But it's, those are things that you can work on so that when that situation pops up in chord progressions, you know how to do that. You know,
can I add something to that?
Sure.
So I would say if the question is how do you sort of dial in arpeggios over certain chords, I love your example. One of the things that I'll do is learn a major arpeggio in a couple different places where you know where the root note is, so that if you're in G major, you can play, you can knock one of those guys out. Mm-hmm. If you're in, and so there are major chords that have different articulations, but the major arpeggio just basically hits three of those notes. Mm-hmm. So it's a generalized sort of umbrella that would cover a lot of different major chords. As long as it's a major chord, for the most part, major arpeggio is going to work. So mm-hmm. you can blanket over a number of different things and, you know, like, you know, learn them in different spots. So mm-hmm. you can know when you can throw them in major and minor versions. Major. Or combine them.
Yeah, and they work great for runs like that, you know, things that they're perfect for that. But I think they also, you know, in addition to sounding insanely cool, and one day we'll all be able to get it to that level, JP, you know, it also shows you your inside notes. It shows you the notes that are, you know, like I said, resolved. So, you know, if you start working with more notes, like the scale, for instance, that would be, you know, seven notes. Mm-hmm. You have that framework to kind of work around. So yeah. You're either sort of playing on those arpeggio notes as a reference point. So like the way I look at it is like this, if you're doing, like here's a good, like we're talking about the G, right? If we're doing this, right? If I put my hand here, what should make me big for 1 second there, JP, if you don't mind, if you make the screen, but yeah. Can you plot me up there for a second? So if you're looking at this shape, please look at this. And now when I take it away, please keep that in your mind's eye. Can you still see it? 3, 5, 5, 4, 3, 3. Okay, ready? Now when I play shape like that, you can see that they're all still there. So when I can kind of see that as I'm playing. All right, hopefully you can kind of see that. That's that visualization that you can do with that. So when you play a shape like that, like I said, whether you're playing the arpeggio straight up or some kind of arpeggio idea, or playing a scalar idea, you have that as kind of a knowledge of, you know, where that's going to resolve. So yeah, that is the idea. Thank you, sir. So there's a multitude of things like that to work on, or of great variety. I mean, so it's just a matter of taking one thing at a time. There's actually another book. Let me see. I recommend a lot of stuff because I'm kind of a book junkie. There's a Troy Nelson book, and I think it's downstairs. I got two shelves of these things. It's one of those. He's got like those 365 day a year books, but our day, you know, less lick a day kind of thing. I forget what it's called. But he basically runs through. He has like a lick a day, but it's like he goes through each chord, and it's like you do one chord per week. So like you might do a week of just B7, and you know, and it kind of takes it this one lick in this position, and then this lick in another position. And the weekend there's more shredding stuff or something, but I'm forgetting what that's called. But anyway, that's a great book that runs through all of those chords. You just go through it. I actually ran through it from a teacher's point of view. I got to it later, but it was helpful because I ran through everything. And actually, I found that, you know, I sort of knew that stuff, but I knew it a little better after doing that one. So that's one I recommend. So anyway, this Troy Nelson, I think he used to be an editor for Guitar One. So that's my plug for him, wherever he is. So yeah, but that's what I would say. I'll just take it one chord at a time. And then for certain chord progressions, you can sort of learn, you know, it just depends on how the chords are kind of zipping by. If they're going by fast, you can think about one scale. If there's more time in a chord, you can sort of play on that chord more and aim for chord tones as you're kind of learning to play changes, you know. So style to do that first with is blues. I think we both agree blues is a good place to start with changes.
Blues is interesting too, because the standard blues progression ending on the 5 has a natural resolution to the 1, right?
Yeah.
So if you want to get back to a note, end on a 5, and it typically sounds pretty good. It sounds pleasing to get you back to where that is. And 5 being, you know, if you take the Ionian scale 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you know, your 5 chord.
Yeah,
totally. All right, what else we got, Nick?
Okay, well, that's pretty much all the topics. The last good question is from my dear friend on Instagram, Nico. Absolutely super nice dude, metal guitar player. And he had a question about how to overcome writer's block. And I think, Jason, you said you had some things to say about that, if you want to.
Yeah, well, so one of the reasons I got into playing guitar was to create. I love the idea of studying other players and then figuring out the things that I thought were cool that they did and try to articulate them in my own style and integrate them into my own playing so that I could create my own music and, you know, kind of express myself that way. Now, I'm constantly creating music. I'm constantly creating. And here are some tips. Here are some things that I'll do to kind of change it up if things aren't feeling fresh. One, play something on a different instrument. Grab a different instrument. Grab a ukulele. Grab an acoustic guitar. Try a different tuning. Do something that is not what you're normally doing. And just noodle with it. Have a little fun. Something, if you're a guitar player, you're going to find something. Something interesting is going to happen. And it's going to trigger something. There's something there. Try a glockenspiel, right? Play something on a glockenspiel. You're going to come up with something. I guarantee it. And it may lead nowhere, but it's something new. It's something creative. Here are some other things. Play to something. A lot of times just a simple, you know, sound can trigger a thought, right? whatever it is, but play a drone note and just play to it. Play anything. And don't be too specific about what you're playing. Just kind of almost meditation. Just go there and see what these thoughts bring you and explore them. Drum beats are great too. Throw on a drummer in Logic, or you know, grab something that go on YouTube and find some backing tracks and just play to that. Any of those things can kind of spark ideas, at least for me. And the other thing, and Nick talked about this too, is study those people that you like. Study the styles of music that you like. Listen to them. Sometimes if I'm writing a song, I'll actually find three different tracks by three totally different artists. They might be different styles too. I'll bring them into a session. I use Logic for recording, for example. It's kind of like GarageBand. Bring them in there and listen to them, and then map out how long are they? How do they have an intro? Is it an intro, verse, pre-chorus, chorus? What is the structure? Start looking at those things and maybe take one of them and map your own structure. It can be in a totally different key. It can be in a totally different style, but use their exact same length and structure and build your own song to that. It just creates some sort of, it's not, what was the term that you used? Parameters. It gives you some new creative parameters that you can use. And I found that when I've gone through the exercise and I take some songs that I like, maybe even just one, and I pull it in and I map it out that way, and I'll create something in a totally different key. No one would know that that was the inspiration for the song, but it naturally will take you somewhere. So just some ideas off the top of my head. The other thing is driving. Get in your car and go for a ride, and without getting into a wreck, have your voice memos available so you can record yourself. Sing melodies when no one's around. Something about driving. I saw this interview with Willie Nelson. He talked about he would go driving and he'd come up with lyrics for his hit songs. He'd write albums in his car. He'd just have to get home before he could forgot them. So, you know, with voice memos, I've got hundreds, loads of voice memos. So you can capture that moment of inspiration. Mm-hmm. So these are all little techniques that I do. The other place that's interesting is the shower. And I think the reason, does this happen to you, Nick? Do you, in the shower, like melodies, notes, things come to you in the shower?
I think I'm way better of a singer in the shower than I actually am.
Yeah, me too. I'm definitely better when no one's around. I think it has to do with there's this sort of drone sound in the shower. There's this little tone. There's a reverberation. There's something that you can play off of from a melody standpoint. And it sounds kind of pleasing and nobody else is around. So any and all of those things can help help me, and maybe something to consider.
Yeah, for sure. No, those are all amazing suggestions. And I've done a few of those things, and I've had common experiences, especially with when you take inspiration from something else and turn it into your own thing, that it's like, you know, that you ripped off Black Sabbath or whatever, but all of a sudden it's like, nobody knows that. They're not hearing that. You know, you took it and made your own thing. So I've had that experience many times. Not that I do that deliberately, but I'm like, I was inspired by this.
You
but
should. It's fine. Yeah. It's fine to do that. It helps even if you can choose two different songs at the same time and map them, because then there's enough variation in the two that your creation has multiple inspiration points.
I used to do that with my leads a lot. I want to say 15 years ago, something like that. I would map it out. I'd be like, you know, Steve Morse thing, Kirk Hammett thing. That's how I wrote it. I mean, it was literally like, I was just like, I did where I took those inspiration, but I did my own variations on it. So as I'm fond of saying in my lessons, I draw my pick at home too, I believe. And I was going to say, for me, it's a mixture of advising new and old. So, and in terms of listening, so you want to listen. I find that helps to listen to new music, something new that I haven't listened to. And, like you were talking about playing different instruments, listening to different instruments for inspiration, listening to different styles of music, something that you like. I'm not saying don't listen to something that's you can't stand, but listen to something you haven't heard before. And the old part of it is to find that spark that first got you playing guitar. Like for me, it's like, you know, sometimes I have to go back and just jam Metallica. And I'll just, you know, I'll shut the door and I'll just play along with Ride the Lightning or something. And then, you know, it's, I always know I had a good session. My wife comes in and she's just like, oh man, it stinks in here. It's like I got the juices flowing, you know. There's something about that. So that's really gross. I'm sorry, but it's you know, you got the stank going. There's something good happening, you know.
Hey man,
so,
that's where funk got its name, right?
Exactly. Exactly. So, but that for me, the listening is absolutely crucial because I'll hear something and oh, yeah, look at this. My buddy Nick. Actually, it's funny. My friend Nick Dilley, a good friend, longtime friend, playing a band together. We were just talking about having different ideas he's one of the guys I've talked with that over and over and over. He's probably the person that taught me that you can listen to some Final Fantasy song from video games and then turn it into your own song and nobody hears that influence except you. And it's something unique now. So, Nick,
everything we come up with has been inspired by something we've heard in nature and movies and TV and so the trick is just have fun with it and do your own thing. One thing to add, sometimes it's helpful for me if I get into a rut to just not play, to take a day off, take a week off. Don't play the guitar for a couple days and then come back to it. And then you come in fresh and then it feels good. You got your mojo back. You want to play your instrument. So sometimes taking a break might be good.
Totally. Yeah. Especially for people who are very serious about it. In fact, at music schools, they oftentimes recommend that. I know at Berklee they did. Nobody did. Nobody took 2 weeks off like they recommend. I mean, people are too serious for that, you know, at Berklee, but or musicians that's doing any of those places. But like the whole idea is just to give yourself a break to absorb some of that material. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the chops go away, but all of a sudden your brain assimilates all the stuff you've been practicing for some time. And all of a sudden you come back. And the other thing that does that is travel. And I realize that's not I'm not really recommending that right now, but in general, when you go to a new place, you have new experiences and you come back.
Changes your environment.
It changes, who you are in a way, because it's like the first time you travel overseas or something, you come back and you're different and you're going to play different because you are different. So, I'm sorry, that's not the best advice right now, but you know, when we can all travel again safely, I would try that. And I do have one recommendation for a book. This is a cool book. This is, Steal Like an Artist. It's a very simple book. Somebody on Instagram recommends, I forget if Giuseppe did that for me, but it's a quick read. You can read it and, you know, sit down and read it in, I don't know, an hour or something like that. But it gets into, you know, things like getting over writer's block and how we use creativity. And it's kind of like what we're saying here. It's like, you know, you take bits that you like and make them your own. So anyway, that's, you know, in terms of writer's block, that's a book I would check out too. So let's see. Comment.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Yo, you got some comments?
I do. Yeah. It's like I said, it's my buddy, Nick Dilley, and I just blocked it. I can't see it. Let's try that again. This is the exciting portion.
This is fun, man.
I'm hearing it for it. Thanks for the shout out. Absolutely. Yeah. I love you, Nick. He's an amazing, amazing friend of mine, longtime friend. And we're kind of guitar playing buddies and we write stuff all the time, way back to things like Badass Opus and what's the, the most recent term was, he's going to remember Terran Epoch. He'll tell you the riff we wrote, heavy metal song. But anyway, so, I think that's all the topics. It's funny.
That's awesome.
Jason and I, we sat down, we're like, okay, maybe we'll do this and that. And then I put a thing on Instagram and I got like a huge, not a huge response, but a pretty big response with a lot of topics. So, there it is. The tune is called Epoch Terra Oblivion. So, it's one of those things. He's like, dude, I'm in town. I'm going to be there at midnight. You want to jam? I'm like, yes. So we went in the garage and jammed this tune. That's, you know, this heavy metal tune. And so one of these days we'll finish it. But, JP and I planned all this stuff and then it completely went a different direction. So, I'm glad it did.
Basically the fans wrote the script for the show. So
yeah, no, it's great. So I appreciate everybody who wrote in suggestions and all the kind words. It's very much appreciated. This is a lot of fun And I appreciate just letting us go off and talk about guitar stuff and goof around for a while here. So.
Yeah, really. I'm actually happy with myself. I've been so tempted to just be noodling this whole time because I got this guitar. But I've been good about it. I've been hanging back. It has been a real pleasure chatting with you tonight. And man, I feel like we can just go on forever. And I'd love to have you back on the show again. Mm-hmm. And really appreciate everyone hanging in there for, gosh, we've been going live for an hour and 40 minutes. And so that's really cool. I'm planning to, I'll look through all the comments and I'd love to follow our fellow musicians out there. So I'll be checking out your stuff as well. Thanks for tuning in, and have a great night. Happy Sunday, everybody.
Thanks for having me. Thanks for tuning in, everybody.
All right. Bye now.